Hello and welcome to the Fans Boxing Podcast, the podcast that asks the questions you want to hear. And I'd like to welcome to this week's show, the very own, Sunderland's very own, sorry, Tony Jeffries. Are you alright, mate?
Good, mate. How are you?
I'm brilliant. Thanks for coming on the show today, mate, and giving up your time.
It's my pleasure, mate. It's my pleasure. There's a big time difference between us, so it's good. It's good that we can connect and get on.
Yeah, it's brilliant. It's brilliant. Like I say, it's been great collecting the questions and the feedback for you over the weeks, and I'd like to kick you off. How it all started for you in boxing, please, Tony? Because a lot of people like to know about your uncle's career that influenced you.
Yeah. So yeah, my uncle was a professional fighter. Ever since I started learning to walk when I was like 4 years old, 3 years old, my granddad used to have us in boxing stance when I was out of punch because his son was a professional boxer, Billy Bryce. He never had that many pro fights. He had about 100 no amateur fights. But yeah, so it was in the family, and then I got took to the gym when I was 10 years old, and it went from there, really. It went from there. There was lots of ups and downs. As a 10-year-old, 11-year-old, I wanted to be outside, getting up to no good with the other kids around the blocks, you know. And then from there, me dad really dragged us to the gym and made us go. And when I was 13 years old, I won the schoolboys the title. I was national champion. And then I won another one, then another one. And then I started winning all sorts of titles, getting picked for England when I was 15. And I had a very good amateur career, and then an okay professional career.
Yeah, because obviously early on in your career, would you say it was forced on you a bit, having the people around you?
Yeah, boxing was definitely forced on us. It was something what I didn't want to do when I was like 12 years old. I'd rather play outside with my friends and do loads of mad shit, get up and no good, and play on my bike and all that. But yeah, my dad made us go to the gym, or he would have grounded us. So I thank him for it now. I hated him at the time, but I thank him for it now.
Yeah, that's the thing I'm going through with my son. It's weird that he's 10 years old, and I feel like I'm forcing it on him at the minute. But that's just to know when you're forcing it, and is it good for him or bad for him, isn't
it? Yeah, I think it's good for them to force them to get in there and keep fit. But I think I was one of the blessed ones who come through and made something of it. Like, I've got two daughters, and I wouldn't want them to be getting punched in the face, you know. That's a whole different story. We can go down that path in a bit. But yeah, I thank my dad for it now, because obviously of what I've achieved and where I am right now in life, it's all through boxing.
Yeah, so it's been brilliant. It's brilliant. And can you just talk us through, like, leading up to, like, the Commonwealth Games and stuff like that?
The Commonwealth Games, yeah, so I won the senior ABAs when I was, I think I was 19, and I got picked for the Commonwealth Games. There was an England box-off tournament as well, and I won that one. And I went to the Commonwealth Games, and the Commonwealth Games I lost in the quarterfinals for a medal. I lost to Kenny Anderson. I don't know if you know who he is, Scottish lad.
He turned pro, didn't he? Yeah.
Yeah, I won my first two fights, and then I stopped two kids, and then I was beating him in the last round, but he came on top and he beat us by a few points, so I never medalled in there. But it was good, because if I did win a medal in the Commonwealth Games, I would have turned professional, and then I wouldn't have went to the Olympic Games. Exactly. You know, and the Olympic Games is like 100 times bigger than the Commonwealth. So, yeah.
You had hand surgery after the Commonwealth. Do you think that affected you in the tournament?
I'm not going to make excuses because it was that long ago, but I think it did. I was getting anaesthetic injected into my hand before each fight, so my hand was numb. When I was in there, I got punched really hard. But yeah, it did affect us, but no excuses. The better man beat us at the end of the day. But it was a great experience. Like I say, it happened for the reason, I think. Well, I don't believe everything happens for a reason, but it happened, and luckily it did, because I wouldn't have went to the Olympics if I won them, you know.
Yeah, of course. Talking about Olympics there, how was that, obviously, Beijing to start with, the whole country and everything like that?
Beijing was a shithole, mate. I'll tell you the truth. It was a shithole. It was horrible. It was full of smog and that, but the occasion was absolutely fantastic. It was amazing. And see, I got put on an 8-year training program when I was 16 years old. It was me and 50 of the boxers. Not many people know this. 50 of the boxers got put on this 8-year training program at the age of 16. The reason why it was 16 is because they say when you're 24, that's when you peak in age. So they got all the 16-year-olds and put money into them. And the reason that we got money that the boxing had money was through Ollie Harrison. And I know Ollie Harrison gets so much stick and gets so much shit, but he's done so much for boxing that people don't realise. Like, if he never won that gold medal, the funding wouldn't have been there for the likes of Amir Khan, myself, James DeGale, Anthony Joshua. All of them, that really stemmed through Ollie Harrison getting the funding for us. So yeah, I got put on the 8-year training program, and then I went through that 8 years, and to qualify for the Olympics, I fought in Chicago. I boxed four times in 1 week, and to qualify, I beat the American team captain in Chicago, and it was a stadium full of like 5,000 people all chanting USA, USA.
Was that Christopher Downs? Was that?
That's right, mate. Yeah. You've been doing your research. That's
of
good.
Of course. Yeah.
So Christopher Downs, who beat before I boxed him, he beat the favourite of the tournament, Ismail Salik, the Black Russian.
Yeah. He went pro as well, didn't he?
Yeah, he was doing good. He got knocked out a couple of times, but he was the one of the best amateurs in the world at the time, and he beat him, and then I beat the American, you know. So to qualify was the best feeling in the world, and when I qualified, I felt my life started to slowly change. People started saying, "Oh, that's the guy who's going to the Olympics. That's the guy who's going to the Olympics." And for being from Sunderland, the Northeast, it's no one had ever been to the Olympics from my city, so I started getting a bit of a name there. Do you know, and then to finally go to the Olympics and come back with a medal, it was like different level, mate. It was the best feeling ever.
Oh, so that's crazy. But you got a bye in the first round. How'd that affect you?
It was so good, mate. It was getting the bye in the first round was amazing because I found out like I think it was 6 weeks before the Olympics. I went to a tournament with. It was in, where was it? It was Finland, and it was Frankie Gavin was on the team, and Kyle Yafai, and I think Joe Murray. And I boxed the world bronze medalist, who was a Lithuanian, southpaw, and he hit me with a left hand, and he cracked one of my ribs. So I won the fight, and the next day I pulled out.
Oh, God.
That really fucked my preparation for the Olympics. I never had great preparation. I never got that much sparring, although me and James DeGale was doing a bit of technique sparring, but I couldn't get hit in the rib because I found this out, so it really disheartened us. So to get there and then finally get the bye, I was like, yes, that's fucking great news. And then I was getting anaesthetic injected into my rib 30 minutes before I was going to the stadium to fight, to numb my rib, because it was painful when I was breathing heavy. That's another thing I've not really told people that because it's like excuses, you know. But yeah, so getting the bye was great, and then after that I fought
Alvarez, was it the Colombian?
Alvarez, yeah.
Really
he's
good fighter.
Really,
yeah.
He's doing really well now. One of our lads
from Norwich went over to fight him in Canada, sorry, Danny McIntosh.
He did?
Yeah. And he lost the fight, but he's a really good lad, that Colombian.
How did that fight go?
I think he got stopped late on, Danny did.
Oh, he did?
Yeah, but put up a good fight. And
Alvarez is a good fighter, mate, and I had a very close fight with him. And because we never had a Cuban in the Olympics at my weight because that Colombian sparked the Cuban out. So I was like, shit, this guy's a big puncher. So luckily I got through that.
Was that five by close back? Count back, mate.
I very, very close. And you know what the funny thing is, I watched it after and I was hitting them with some jabs and they weren't scoring. But then I should have had these extra points. But then in the last round, he hit me with the uppercut, clean uppercut, knocked my head back, and that never scored either. So thank fuck that never scored. I wouldn't be speaking to you right now. You know what I mean? So
yeah.
That's the way it goes. So luckily the judges weren't on point really on that. But if they were on point, I would have won by a few more points. But it was a good fight to get through that. And then the next one I had the Hungarian. I'm sure you know his name.
Oh, no, I can't pronounce his name. I'm really bad with foreign names, to be honest.
Yeah, I can't pronounce his name either. Sleslo or whatever.
Yeah.
He was ranked in the world as well, and I beat him and got the medal. So I give him a standing count in the last round as well. It was a great experience to come with the medal.
Yeah, because obviously that was a great experience and all that. What do you think went wrong against the Irishman in Egan?
Kenny Egan, he was better than us.
Yeah.
Basically,
Yeah,
he was better than us. He was cleverer, he was smarter than us, he was more experienced, and I really struggled with southpaws. So I couldn't do anything with him. I tried my hardest, and I was gutted before, gutted after the fight. I lost the fight because I was confident. I thought, man, I'm going to beat him, because when I've just told you the Lithuanian who cracked me rib, who I beat, yeah. I beat him pretty easy. He beat Kenny Egan in the tournament as well, so he'd already beat Kenny Egan. So I thought, right, he's beat him. I can beat him because I'm better than him. So, yes. So that, and I never. So he's just too clever. He's smart. He's a good lad. Good lad. And then Kenny Egan should have really won the gold medal in the final, I think.
Yeah,
but he never did.
But obviously, now in amateurs without the headgear, do you think that would have been good for you then back then?
No, I preferred it the way it was. So when I turned professional, I had 96 amateur fights, and in them 96 amateur fights, I only ever got one cut in all the sparring and all of the training I'd done and all the fights. One cut on my eye, and that was off Kenny Egan when I fought him earlier on. He hit his left hand. Then when I turned professional, I had 10 professional fights. In them 10 professional fights, I got cut. I think it was 7 times in 10 professional fights.
Jesus Christ.
50 stitches in my face, and that none of them was through punches. Every single one of them was through head clashes. You know, so in amateurs, I would have been shredded. My face would have been cut to pieces.
Yeah, that's very true.
So I really believe that it should have been the amateurs should steer with head guard, and I think it's for a lot of reasons. It's something. It's a strong point that I feel about boxing for a lot of reasons. One reason is the. I'm going to ask you a question now. When does the Joe Public see amateur boxing? When do they ever see it?
Not on the television or nothing really.
No, but when it's on the TV, when do they see it? It's in the big tournaments, right? It's in the
Commonwealth Games.
In the Olympic Games. So now if I'm a parent and I'm watching boxing on TV and I'm seeing people getting cut, because people get cut more now with head clashes, I'm not going to put my kid into that sport. Do you know what I mean?
Exactly.
It looks more brutal. So there's a big reason there why I'm not going, why it's bad for boxing, because parents see that, no, I'm not going to let my kid, even though it's Olympic sport, they're getting their faces cut. That's not happening. It's also bad for your hands as well. I don't think people realise, because I'm not punching a head guard. Now I'm punching a skull, a hard skull.
Yeah.
So I had bad hands, as you know. So that would have killed me hands as well. You know what it is? It's the EIBA. It's a money thing for them, because now them's trying to do professional boxing.
Yeah.
With the WSB. So to do that, they're getting the boxers experience at fighting 3-minute rounds, at fighting without head guards on. I really believe that it's a big long-term money plan goal for the EIBA or whatever it's called. You know, so that's what I think is. I think it's a bit of a scam, and I think it's bad for boxing.
Yeah,
but I know
yeah.
a lot of people out there disagree with us, and a lot of people think it's better for boxing. It's more like a real fight, but that's bullshit. It's a sport. It's too brutal. Leave that shit for the pros, and that's the way I believe it anyway.
Yeah, no? Yeah. I'd say obviously you turn pro, and big pressure put on you straight away with like having your medal presented at Stamford Bridge then, Stadium Light, sorry.
Yeah.
How was that feeling?
It was great. Turning pro was great. I started earning some good money, because before I made any money through boxing, I was working on a catering trailer, and I was working on a nightclub doorman. So it was great to finally earn some money, get some recognition for all the years I've done training, and then leading up to your question, the pressure was hard, mate. No one ever explained to me about the pressure and about the critics, and it was all brand new to us, because like I say, I was just a normal lad. Next thing I'm in the public eye, and everything was brand new to us. I fought a guy called Nathan King, who was a journeyman. Tough guy, journeyman.
Yeah.
And remember in that fight, it was a 6-round fight. I won every round. He hit us with a right hand, decent shot. And the amount of stick I got off the commentators, off people on forums and on social media, was ridiculous, because I got caught with one right hand. I was like, fuck, I got caught with a right hand. It's boxing. And I couldn't believe it. And it really hurt us quite a bit, you know, like getting this people, oh, he's shit him, he's not going to make it. And if Nathan King's landing big shots at that, if it was a big puncher, he would have been knocked out. And it's like, God. And it was so tough for me to deal with mentally.
Now looking back, do you think that's just what the media does now, just to wind things up? Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, the media does it to build it up and for the fans. It sounds good. You always want a bit of drama to entertain. If it's not, it's boring. If I'm just punching someone's head in for six rounds, and you know, but it is excited. But the thing is, people don't realize, like, these sports stars or athletes, the people as well, like, you know, and it affects you. Especially when I was green, it was brand new, and I never expected any of this. Do you know what I mean? I never expected anything. It's just like now, if someone starts seeing you, I know you're putting time and effort into your podcast. If someone said, "Now that podcast is fucking shite," but not just one person. Let's say you're getting 100 people to, "Nice shit, that podcast. He speaks funny. I can't understand this. His questions are crap. He needs to do more research." Like, it affects you. Like, exactly. Like I'm no different to you. But when someone's telling you what you love and what you're doing, your passion, someone telling you you're crap at it, it's like, fuck, no one told us I'm going to expect this. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, that affects you obviously deep down, doesn't it?
Yeah, big time.
They say, obviously early on in your pro career, you were fighting, you had three fights in Sunderland. How was that important for you?
It was great. That was a big reason why I signed with Frank Maroney, because of, he promised his fights in Sunderland, and it was amazing. There was something like 1,200 tickets in 7 minutes when
Jesus
we released
Christ.
Them. And it was like, shit, God, couldn't believe it. But yeah, it was amazing. And the support, that first time I fought in Sunderland, it was my second pro fight. I was nearly crying, walking out to the ring because of the support I got. It was unbelievable. People chanting my name, singing songs. I got goosebumps. It was a weird experience because, like I say, I was nearly crying on the way to the ring. Luckily, I fought. The guy I fought was the worst person I've ever boxed in my whole entire life. I had 105 fights in my life, 106 fights, and this guy was terrible. He was a journeyman. So, yeah, I took care of business, and that was the most I ever got paid for a fight as well. So, I'm happy with that.
You say the first five fights, they were, like, say, against foreign journeymen. How much did you learn in them fights?
You do learn a little bit. You do learn a bit, but... yeah, I mean, you don't learn so much, like, especially the way I was just blasting them all out. But yeah, I suppose you learn, because as an amateur, I've always boxed with a vest on and a head guard, and never even sparred without a head guard on. So going there without it was good. And then under the lights, so I mean, I think it's pretty important that you get a few of them fights in, definitely. But the main thing is, well, for me, I was making good money as well, so I was happy with that.
Yeah, so that's a business side of it as well, isn't there?
Yeah.
Moving on to the Michael Bambula fight, I think you pronounced his name right.
Yeah.
A lot been said about that, about the rounds mix up. Could you clear that up for us, Tony?
Yes, definitely. So, and I was being talked about this today. Actually, I'm doing an interview in the morning with someone wants to do something on my life, and I was telling him about it. Yeah, so the Michael Bambula fight in Sutherland, 8 weeks out. It's my first 8-rounder, right? 8 weeks out from the fight, I pull a muscle in my arm. I can't spar, I can't do any. I called Frank Maroney. Frank, I'm pulling out this fight. I can't spar, I can't do any training. He said, "Oh, you can't pull out. It's in Sunderland. We've sold all these tickets for the venue and all that." I went with Frank. I'm not fighting. They're 100%. I'm fighting. Especially not 8 rounds. I've never even. I'm not got no spar and all that. He said, "Oh, he's a journeyman." I went, "Mate, I'm not fighting. That's it. The fight's off." We'll tell everyone. All right, he calls us back. "Tony, we've sorted it. We want to do a 6-round fight. Can you do that?" I was like, "Not really. I don't want to fight." I said, "My arm's fucked." So he's like, Tony, it's 6 rounds, you'll just get through it." And all that. I went, "All right, we'll do it." So I've done all my other training, couldn't spar. So I'm training for this 6-round fight. When I seen Frank Maroney in the ring, I remember saying to him, "Are they going to ask me in the interview about my injury and about, like, when I'm going to step up to 8 rounds? He went, "No, they'll not ask you that." I went, "All right, fine." So I'm fighting. After the 6 rounds, I'm absolutely exhausted. Goes to a referee from the raise my hand. He says there's 2 more rounds left. That broke me on. It's like if you imagine doing a 6-mile run. In the last mile, you give it everything you've got. You get the finish line, you're exhausted, you want to just sit down and rest. And then they say, "Oh no, you've got 2 miles left."
Yeah.
That's exactly what it was like. I was broke. And made us really hate boxing and hate Frank Maloney and just hate the fact that the way things was done. Because all my team, like me trainer Bobby Rimmer, me other trainer Sean Casey, just me strength and conditioning people, everyone thought it was a six rounder, run up to it, and then to find out it was eight after the sixth round was horrible, mate.
Yeah.
I was thrown up in the dressing room after because I was of exhaustion. I could have been badly hurt. I don't even know how I finished the fight. I could have been badly hurt, and that's come down to Frank Maloney being, I don't know, greedy or dishonest. And I said to him after, "What the fuck was that all about?" He said, "No, I thought it was a six round as well." That's what he said, but obviously he never.
Yeah. Well, I'm glad you cleared that up for us, Tony. A lot of people want to know about that.
Yeah, I hear that. That's the things about boxing, about corruption and corrupt pieces of shit. That's one thing that was bad about, you know.
So looking over your pro career, a lot of people ask, who do you think the best opponent you went in with?
Pro career was, I don't know. Probably Matt Haney, but nah. I never really boxed anyone, no disrespect to them all, but I never boxed anyone really in my league, not being big at it, because I boxed all journeymen really for my first 10 fights. So I never really won. I boxed way better opponents in the amateurs. You know, I boxed for England 57 times. So every time you box for England, you box a champion of a different country. So I boxed 57 different champions. Which were all better than all the guys I fought as a pro.
Yeah, that's fair enough, Tony. That's fair enough.
Yeah.
I'd say, obviously, it's bad to think about it now, but could you just talk us through the injury and when you found the news that you'd never box again, mate?
Yeah, so the injuries was something I had for a while, like I said, in the Commonwealth Games. That was when I was, I think, 20 years old. Before that, when I was 17, 18, I was always having bad hands. I was a big puncher for a young kid. And so I always had these bad hands, and then it got to the point, like when I was training in America, like where I couldn't turn a key, I couldn't button my trousers, I was icing my hands 3-4 times a day, before training, after training, I couldn't make proper fists, and it got so bad after my last fight. I went and seen the guy, and I scanned him. He said, "You've got a hole in one knuckle, you've got a tear in your other tendon, your other hand, your hands are like terrible, you need to get surgery, you've got no option." So I seen Dr. Mike Hayton, who's done surgery on everyone's hands, like Amir Khan, Tony Bellew, Paul Smith, everyone's hands. He's a doctor, great guy, and they just never recovered. Now I can't make fists with either hand, like proper fists. I still punch, but I can't make proper fists. So I waited for about a year before I announced my retirement, and then I retired, and it was one of the hardest things I've ever had to do. I've done a big status on Facebook and posted that, and yeah, it was so hard, because I never really had anything to turn back on. I had a few quid in the bank off saving me money off boxing, and I was smart, and I bought some houses as well, got mortgages on houses, but I never had anything to fall back on. So I was out in LA trying to get my hands, waiting for my hands to get better, and they never did. So it was time to call it a day.
Because a lot of people have asked me, it might sound a stupid question to yourself, but over the years, like with technology changing, nothing can change in that department, mate.
No, so I even got this treatment. It's called PRP. I don't know if you've heard of that.
No,
I don't know what it stands for. It's where they take the blood and the spit the white and the red blood cells up, and then they inject I think it's the white blood cells back into the affected area, which helps with arthritis, and that really speeds up the healing and speeds up all that. So they've got a couple of different versions of that. They've got the PIP, where they take the blood out of your arm, or they've got even another one, what's supposed to be even better, where they take bone marrow out of your hip.
Jesus.
And that's what I got. They were fucking hammering and big needle into my hip.
Oh.
It was horrible. And then they injected it into my hands with no anaesthetic. Into my knuckles, he said, "I can put anaesthetic in if you want, which will help the pain, help the numb, but you'll not be able to get as much of these cells in your hand." So I went, just do it raw. So he did it.
Oh, mate!
Yeah,
Jesus.
Mate. In the front of my knuckles. So I got that and waited, and nothing. So I tried everything, but Mate, tell you what now, tell you the truth now, it's the best thing that could happen to us. It's the best, it really is. I'm so happy that that happened and I wasn't continuing boxing. Because now life is better than ever. Life is better than ever.
Yeah, that's a weird bit of feedback of some bloke. He said he didn't want to come across disrespectful, but you could have ended up a punch drunk fighter, couldn't you, after all them years? And
yeah, maybe, exactly.
Everything for a reason, as you said yourself.
Yeah, exactly. And that's the most important thing in your head, you know. I'm even feeling effects now with my brain after having the 106 fights. I really am, and I believe it's through boxing. But I'm not terrible, you know. I'm smart enough to realise that I think there might be a little problem there, if that makes sense.
Yeah, of course.
It does take an effect. I'm 30 years old now, but if I was fighting until I was 30 years old, I would have took another 10, 20, 30,000 punches to the head, and so it went well, really. It couldn't have went better.
Yeah, because obviously at the end of your career, you were training out in America. Can you tell us how the getting the gym came about?
So Frank Mooney recommended a trainer who was called Tommy Brooks. Tommy was a guy who trained Mike Tyson for 6 or 8 fights. He trained Holyfield for a few fights. And so I come up to America to work with him, and I just wanted to change the scene. I love Bobby Rimmer, who I trained with for most of my pro career. Great, good trainer, great guy. But after that draw, I needed to get out, get away from Sunderland and get away from just the UK, really. And so I come out here, and it was a great move. And Tommy was a very good trainer, and I had 3 fights for him. So yeah, it was good. And that's another thing, one of the best things I've ever done, come to America. So I've got a life for myself out here now, where I'm pretty set, you know.
Yeah, because we have a lot of banter with the American fans about their fighters and how, because their school process and college and stuff like that, they think their fighters are more athletes because the way they've been brought through. Do you agree with that?
Right. No, definitely not. I mean, the Americans, not well. Maybe they've got more athletes. Yeah, because in schools and that, but not when it comes to boxing. The American boxing program is the shot one. It's horrible. They've not even got one compared to the Great Britain one, where Terry Edwards put together the amateur program. Is absolutely amazing what Great Britain's got, and I think it's shown by the results in the Olympics from the last 2 Olympic Games, and I think it's going to get even better and better. They've got the best fighters in the world, amateur fighters in the world, what's now filtering up into the pro ranks and giving us the best pro fighters in the world. You know? So England's definitely better than America on the boxing side of things.
That's great to hear, mate. That is great to hear.
Yeah. Yeah.
So moving forward, like, you're working with obviously boxers in your gym, and you've moved on to mixed martial artists as well. Can you talk us through that, please, Tony?
So I got a phone call off a guy saying, I manage a fighter called Brendan Schaub. He's a UFC fighter, and I didn't even watch the UFC. I was like, all right, he wants to do some boxing work, will you do it? I went, yeah, bring him down, me rates, whatever I was charging then. And he came down, I done a session with him, and we still got on really well, and he absolutely loved it with us, so I've done more with him, more boxing work. And then I start watching UFC and thinking about it, and now I absolutely love the sport. I end up being Brendan's head trainer for 3 of his last 3 fights. He's retired now, and I had a really good time. I trained Ronda Rousey a couple of times, the UFC, the female fighter.
Oh, she brilliant.
In the gym. I done some sessions with her. So, yeah, and another guy called Tom Watson. I think he's from your way, Tom Watson.
Yeah, Tom Watson. We actually had a question about him today, asking, are you training him?
Yeah, I trained him for a few months, and a quality top bloke. Still contact him now and again, but I don't know where he is, where he's training, or what he's doing, where he's fighting. So I think he lost a few as well.
Yeah,
but
great
lad, and yeah. So now I'm a big, massive UFC fan. I love that sport.
Yeah, how do you compare like the big UFC nights to the big boxing nights? Should we say?
Big UFC is done 10 times better than boxing, and I've said this before, they're so professional. It's like an Olympic standard. The Olympics is the best. It's like Olympic standard compared to like the UFC comedy events is like Olympic standard. The professional events is absolutely shocking, mate. People don't understand how unprofessional a professional is. So I had my gloves 2 weeks before me fight as a professional. I would wear my own gloves as a professional. I'd train in them for 2 weeks. I bet you people don't know this. I've trained in my own gloves for 2 weeks before smashing the pads, getting them worn in and all that, and then fighting them as a pro. It's really, that's horrible. You shouldn't be able to do that. You know what I mean?
Yeah, of course.
It's so unprofessional. I fought in the same gloves like three times. I used to train in them. It's a professional athlete. And as an amateur, obviously, you can't do that. Everything gets checked and all that. I never got drug tested once as a professional. In 10 fights. The whole accommodation was shite. Everything, it was just shit. Where the UFC, it's much more professional. It's like a world title fight. Every single fight, you've got people inspecting your hand wraps, you've got people inspecting. I never got my hand wraps inspected once as a professional either. I got people inspecting the changing rooms all the time. The drug testers are there all the time, and you stop in a Hilton hotel, you get looked after, you get coaches everywhere. Professional, the most unprofessional I've seen. The world class amateurs is way more professional than professional boxing. Yeah, definitely. There's just so much shit and so much what goes on. Even weigh-ins, like you see, like Frank Maloney, he'll tell the guy what the weight is on the scales, and then he'll call it down. Everyone will clap. Like you know, I think he done it with me one time when I was a couple of pound heavier. I never told him no, but he told the guy I was lighter, and then he called it out on the scales. And it's like, fucking hell, I was heavier. Do you know what I mean? It's so unprofessional, so crooked.
Yeah, yeah.
And people, a lot of people don't know this, so this will be new. This will be good stuff for you to share with people, you know. This is the most
exclusive.
Yeah, some exclusive shit here coming out about the professional ranks. Yeah.
Is that a question we had in? Do you think you could have made it as a mixed martial artist?
No, definitely not. Too many injuries, mate. I couldn't have done it. The man, you see them doing leg kicks, and someone kick me in the leg, I think I'd cry, mate. It's horrible. You know?
Headshots only for you, then. Head and body.
Yeah, if it's boxing, I'm good, but none of that kicks and that, mate.
Yeah, so is that the route you're going down now, the mixed martial arts, or just how it comes?
No, so the route I'm going down now is the business route. I've got two gyms. We've got named number one gym in California, which is absolutely amazing, because there's thousands and thousands of gyms, tens of thousands of gyms in California.
Yeah.
And so we've got named number one gym in California. We've got two now. We want to grow more. It's called Box and Burn. We're going to turn it into a franchise. I train some classes. I've got a few clients, high end clients. I train some well known actors and stuff. And that's where the money is. Like, you let's say in boxing, you'll train a boxer who might, let's say, get ten grand a fight. It's a good boxer if he gets 10 grand a fight, and you get 10% of that, you get a grand. Where now I'm training actors for like $200 an hour, and you know it's. You make, there's a lot more money in training fitness out here than there is in the UK. So, I'm not into training fighters, and you put so much time into them. But I'm kind of past training fighters. But I've got so much respect for people who train boxers, like the grassroots, like my old trainers who train you for free. You know what I mean? I couldn't do that.
Yeah.
Some special people out there who train amateur boxers for free, and them's the people who the unsung heroes of this sport. They're volunteers, you know. It's the unsung heroes of boxing. Great guys. But yeah, as for me personally, I'm good on training fighters.
Could we ever see one of your gyms in Sunderland?
You know what? I got asked that the other day on Instagram, but I don't know. I mean, our business model's great. Our class is fantastic. So, and I think it will work anywhere in the world. But if people want to keep fit, see, the thing is with California and where I am now in Santa Monica, it's part of people's lifestyles. Like, you go to work, you eat, you sleep, you work out. That's everyone's lifestyle out here. Where in Britain, it's a little bit different. You know what I mean? They cut that out and they eat more shit. So
exactly.
Yeah. So that's why it works out here. So maybe it would be nice.
You said you touched on it there, and you've been training actors and stuff like that. Is that how you led to getting your acting role yourself in Blacklist?
Well, I trained a director called Joe Conahan, who's a big director. He's done all sorts of stuff, like the movie The Grey, and he wrote and directed The Blacklist. And he just said, I've got a part for that I think you'll be good for. If you want to do it, you have to come to New York. I was like, definitely, mate. I am up for that. So I went, never done any acting or anything in my life. Next thing, I'm getting punched in the face of a woman and doing acting. It's It was an amazing experience. And the Joe Conhan's just wrote Bad Boys 3. Have you seen the Bad Boys movie?
Oh, of course, yeah. Will Smith and that.
Yeah, Will Smith and Martin Lawrence. He's just wrote that, and he's going to direct it. If it all gets signed off by the actors, if Will Smith and that agree to do it, he's going to give me a part in Bad Boys 3 as well.
Oh,
so
you could get the punch in the face by Will Smith then?
I'd love to. So hopefully that comes off as well. It's just been out here, the opportunities that come around. It's mad. It's like a dream come true, living here. Yeah.
Like I say, I've put this out at the start of the thing, but I had got a bit of news in the family as well. I'd like to say congratulations on the newborn as well.
Oh, nice one, mate. Yeah, I've got a newborn. I've got two girls now. Not all I wanted was a boy, I've ended up with two girls. But so that's great. So I haven't slept this night. She's like 1 week old or 10 days old now. So yeah, it's good. So thanks for that, mate.
No worries. And moving on, because there's a lot of feedback about your podcast you do with your friend. Yeah. And a lot of people saying that, of course, you have your background in boxing. That's a big fresh breath of air, having your opinion on fights and analysis.
Yeah.
Really good. How'd that come about, you starting that?
I used to write a column for the Sunday Sun in the northeast of England. And it was a really popular column, and people enjoyed it. And I'd done that for like about 18 months. And I ended up packing that in, and people were like, are you going to write another column? And then my friend Brendan Chab, he's got a podcast called The Fighter and the Kid. I don't know if you've heard of that one. It's one of the best podcasts in the world.
Yeah, I've seen that on the list, yeah.
He's smashing it. And because I didn't even know what a podcast was, and he was telling us, like, oh, I'll look into that, and I've seen how simple it is to start one. And I thought, I'll start one. And it's more of a hobby. Like, I'm sure this is for you. It's a hobby for us, you know. Something I really enjoy doing. And, and I've been told that they're very inspirational, my podcasts. And then I get fighters on. See, I'm friends with so many fighters. I text Billy Joe Saunders the other day. He wanted to come on. Who was the other one? Steve Bunce wants to come on. Tony Bellew wants to come on. So I've got all these people. It's just finding the time to sit down and give them a call and record it. So,
oh, we love to hear that. You have been some great banter of them lads, wouldn't it?
Yeah, see, because they're my friends. And so it's a bit different. We've got like a background and a past together. So yeah, it'll be good. I had Frankie Gavin on my podcast. He was a good friend of mine. I'll get James DeGeele on as well. He's another good friend, Paul Smith. So I've got all these contacts that if I want, I can get them on whenever. So maybe I will in the future. I've all said they will. So
yeah, another one of them stupid questions for you, Tony. Just obviously it's been a hard year. Like as looking back, seeing like James DeGeele and obviously Billy Joe winning world titles, this maybe would have been your year as well.
Yeah. I'm very happy for them. I'm very, very proud of them. When I first retired and I seen some of my friends winning fights, winning titles, I'm going to tell the truth, I was jealous. I was like, shit, you know. But where I am in my life right now, I'm proud of them and I'm happy for them, because, you know, they work so, so hard. So to get what they're doing is absolutely amazing. You know, it really is. And so I'm proud of them, yeah.
It's got some individual questions here for you, Tony. What's the hardest you've been hit in the amateur or pro?
When I was 16, I fought in the European final. And I got hit by off a Greek by a right hand. He rocked us. I got a stand on the account. It was horrible. And then I won the fight. I won the final. I won the European gold medal. I was got on the podium. I got after back in the hotel. And I could not remember a thing about anything about being hit, about being on the podium, but winning the fight or anything. So all the lads, Stephen Smith and that, were taking the piss, you know. You lost the fight, you got knocked out, and I couldn't remember a thing. So I think that was probably when I was 16 year old, got hit the hardest. And then I'll tell you who was one of the hardest hitters I've been in the ring with was Oval McKenzie. I've done some sparring with him.
All right, yeah, yeah.
That guy can punch me. He can dig, yeah. And Tony Bellew, another one, them fought each other. Tony Bellew was a heavy hitter I've been in the ring with. And then I've done some little sparring with David Price as well, just messing around in the English camp. He's like a sledgehammer, like ridiculous. But obviously, he wasn't going for it. But the hardest I've been hit was off that Greek guy, yeah.
Yeah, brilliant. What venue were you most looking forward to fighting in as a pro? Would have been the Stadium of Light,
yeah,
the Pinnacle.
Would have been the Stadium Light, and yeah. Now my dad's doing boxing promotion up in the northeast. He's getting shows in the Stadium Light, not the full stadium. They're cutting off, and he's putting shows there every summer. So would have been really nice for us to fight there, and that was the plan to do that, but obviously it never worked.
Do you get back to Sunderland much? That's another question we were asked.
I've been back two or three times in the last 3 years. So, you know, the thing is now, when I live in LA and I get a chance to go on holiday, I don't really want to go back to Sunderland. I want to go to Miami or Hawaii or Mexico or somewhere like that.
So, I can't really blame you on that one.
Yeah, so, but I've got lots of family there. And the good thing is now, with this day and age, you've got FaceTime, you've got Skype, what you're doing now.
Exactly, yeah.
So you can talk to them and you can see them whenever you want, and it's free. Yeah, so that's good.
It's just, I might have said a bit about it before, but what plans you got going forward for yourself and the gym and everything?
Yeah, so like I said, the gym, I want to franchise the gym, and want to just keep progressing and keep building that and build the Boxing Burn brand. We've developed a certification course where we teach trainers how to become boxing certified. So you get to see a lot of personal trainers. Like I see, it's more out here than in UK. The lifestyle out here, there's thousands and thousands of personal trainers, but none of them know how to teach boxing. So I want to give them a Boxing Burn, bring them in, charge them $200 and teach them how to teach boxing. We've done two courses so far and they've been great. They've sold out. And so teaching people how to teach boxing is a great thing. And I've got a really great relationship with Everlast, and I might be doing something where we link up with them and then have their name behind it as well. So yeah, I mean, out here you never know what happens. Like I see, I was in the blacklist. I might be in Bad Boys 3. You don't know what's going to happen. It's the beauty of living out here, you know?
So I've missed one question out. I should have slipped in. What was it like making weight as an amateur and a pro? A couple of people asked that, to be honest.
Yeah, so making weight was it was all right. It was part of the game. I was so dedicated. There's a lot of fighters, a lot of my friends who on the England camps when they'd put loads of weight on after the fight, but I'd never really done it. I put a bit on, but when I was in camp, I was so dedicated. I was more dedicated than anyone of dieting. I wouldn't eat anything, not even a half a chocolate or even a crisp, because I was just so dedicated. So I made it good because of my dedication, you know. And
yeah, I saw a picture recently on your, I think it was your Facebook, about training on Christmas Day. That was quite a good picture.
Which one was that?
You training on Christmas Day or something? You used to train on Christmas Day, something about your opponents.
Oh, yeah.
Never done that.
It's a status, yeah. I used to like to train and exercise on Christmas Day because I knew my opponent wasn't doing it, so I would do it. That used to motivate us more, just because it was Christmas.
That's crazy to think.
Yeah, but now my weight is, I'm about 15 stone now. I've boxed at 12 stone, but because I'm tall, I can pull it off. Yeah.
That's great to hear. Well, I'll say one more question for you, mate, before we let you go. Just if you can make a couple of fantasy fights for 2016, can you name a couple of them, please, mate?
Ooh, fantasy fights for 2016.
Any fights you like to see?
I would love to see. Because he's one of my good friends, David Price. I would love to see him get in there and fight someone like Derek Chisora.
Yeah.
And to beat him, I would like to see.
That news coming out about obviously Price's opponents he's lost to, that's not very nice to hear, is it?
Oh, it's horrible. It pissed us off. I done a tweet about that. I don't know if you've seen. I was raged at that. So I'd like to see David Price fight someone like Derek Chisora to get him back in the mix, because he'd beat him. And then I would like to see someone like David here fight Anthony Joshua. I think that would be a great fight. I'd like to see my friends do well. Let's see Amir Khan and Kell Brook. That would be another good one.
Yeah, if we can see that this year, it'd be lovely, wouldn't it?
And James DeGale as well. I like to see him fight just whoever. Just as long as they're winning, you know. Billy Joe Saunders. I wouldn't like to see him fight Triple G.
No.
I didn't want to see that.
I'd like to see it, as long as Billy got a few decent fights behind him and a bit more experience on the world level.
Yeah, yeah.
But I just can't see that happening.
The thing is with Billy Joe Saunders, he's the most competitive person I've ever met. Like, I remember we'd be in camp, we'd be playing basketball, like just shoots, like first to 10 wins, and he'd have to win. I'd beat him like 3 times, and he'd be like, "No, one more game," and we'd play until he beat us, and then he'd be like, "All right, now we can leave." So he's just so competitive, which is great. And
of course, I think.
I'd like to see him fight Danny Jacobs and get a couple
more
titles.
Yeah, that'd be a good fight. Yeah,
he'd beat him, and Aye, and we've got, but has Brian Rose's next fight been announced yet?
I don't think so, mate. I don't think so.
Yeah, he's got. I don't know who was fighting, but I kind of thought I'd be something getting announced soon. So he's got a good fight coming up, and I'd like to see someone like Brian Rose fight someone like Chris Eubank Jr.
Yeah. Go up to middleweight and fight him, yeah?
Yeah, he's fighting at middleweight now.
Is it? Sorry, yeah.
Yeah, I think he's had one fight, and his next fight is a big fight at middleweight. And then, I think that will be good. And yeah, so there's some good fights out there, isn't it? Boxing's...
Yeah, I'm really happy with the state of boxing at the minute, to be fair.
Who would you like to see?
Say, I'm a Tyson Fury fan.
Yeah.
I'd like to see him in some good fights, and... I don't know if I'd like to see him fight Hay. I know it's probably not going to happen because of what happened before, but I'd love to see that fight.
Yeah,
after the Klitschko fight, I could think that he beat Hay.
Yeah.
Not many people agree with me. I'll get slagged off for it, but I got slagged off for saying it against Klitschko, so I'll take that in the chin.
See, I think with Tyson Fury in here, if they were going to fight, I would have picked Hay against them. But no, he has been up for so long, it's like, ooh. And now with the way Tyson fought Fury, it really... shows you that he's not just he's a smart fighter, and he's fit and he's strong and he can stand with him, you know. So he's better than I thought he was, because I thought Klitschko was going to be Fury.
Because obviously, one more question, a personal question, being from lower stuff, have you heard of obviously Anthony Ogogo?
Oh yeah,
Anthony Ogogo. he got the bronze medalist and now he's going through injury problems like yourself, isn't he?
I don't know. Can you fill me in? Tell me what he's
got. Yeah, he got injured in a couple of fights before, and he came back and got dislocated his shoulder, I think it was.
Oh.
Oh, and he's going through a hard patch now of like rehabilitation and stuff like that. But it's really similar career to yours, to be honest.
Oh, poor lad. Because I remember on the training camps with him, and someone stole his phone and found a picture of him when he was messing about with, and a picture of him wearing a bra. and one of the boys sent it because Anthony Gould went in the Big Brother house, right? Some kid Brother house thing. So when he was there and he got popular, one of the boys, I'm not going to mention any names because he's a big name now. He sent that picture to the newspapers, and it was in the national newspaper. Anthony Gould report.
Stitch up, absolute stitch up.
Big time, mate, big time. But I mean, he asked for it. Like, I've given his phone to one of the boys, and he's got a picture like that, and he kind of asked for it. But but he's a good fighter, and he's a good guy, always dedicated, and always believed in himself. So, if you see him, just tell him I wish him all the best, and I hope he recovers, and tell him to get in touch with us if he wants any advice or anything anyone to talk to him, you know.
Oh, that's brilliant, Tony. I will pass that on to him. Thank you very much, for that, mate. Looks like thanks for giving up your time tonight, mate. I spoke to you for nearly an hour, and that's been an absolute laugh, and I appreciate every second you give us. Thank you, Tony.
Okay, anytime, mate. And good luck with everything. Good luck with your podcast. It's been a good podcast.
Fair. Thank you, mate. And same to you, mate. And good luck with everything you're going forward.
Thanks, brother. And good luck, mate. See ya.
Yeah, I'll speak to you soon, Tony. Catch you later, mate.
Bye.